So he'll send the information later. But everybody's welcome to attend. 7:30. At 7:30. Okay, the details will give later. Yeah, okay, so take your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, thank you, Rinaldo, Rogerio, for having me here today. And I thought that if the rest of the talk is not inspiring, at least I thought that the first slide can be. So at least enjoy this one. Okay, so the clearly we are all convinced that from the first 2 days that in any case, even though if we don't have signals of new physical colliders, however, cosmology is a cosmological puzzle, are a strongly required new physics. And what we haven't talked so far is that also, however, we have to explain neutrino masses and mixing. So it is a reasonable idea to have an extension of the standard model where you can explain all together. Carlos was saying, for a long time I was studying leptogenesis. Now I became slightly more ambitious. I want to combine also with dark matter, but I'm still behind for inflation and acceleration. Sorry about that. So I don't know. Let's see. I'm doing well. So neutrino masses, we haven't talked, so just briefly, as you norm, I don't know, we have information from neutrino oscillation experiments on two mass square differences. And because of this information, so we know that actually there are, since one of the delta m squared, the sign of the delta m squared atmospheric is not known, we still have also two schemes. So you can have these two different possibility of ordering the neutrinos, normal or inverted ordering. What is still not known is the absolute neutrino mass scale that can be parameterized in terms of the lightest neutrino mass. And whatever this information from neutrino oscillation tells you is that if the lightest neutrino mass is much bigger than the atmospheric scale, neutrino have to be necessarily quasi-degenerate, while if it's smaller than the solar scale, about 10 millielectron volt, then there is some hierarchy, either of inverted or normal type. What is interesting is that there are upper bounds, let's say starting from probably because it's also, there were recently some updates from direct kinematic constraints. So from tritium beta decay, now we have a slightly more stringent upper bound from Catherine than the old one from the Mainz and Troitsky experiment of about 1 electron volt. If you think that your neutrinos are Majorana, then neutrinoless double beta decay also gives us quite strong constraints. The strongest is from the Kamlanzen experiment. But cosmology gives you the strongest one. And in 2015, Planck collaboration gave this upper bound of the sum of the neutrino masses that translates when they are quasi-degenerate into an upper bound on the lightest of 0.07. More recently, using 2018 data from the Planck collaboration, these authors have produced this upper bound, taking into account also that when you go below this scale, you have to take into account neutrino oscillation experiments, so you cannot treat them quasi-degenerate. And they have these two upper bounds on the sum of the neutrino masses, but in the end, you get the same one on the lightest neutrino mass of 0.04 electron volt. That is excluding all quasi-degenerate neutrinos. That is quite interesting. The absolute neutrino mass scale will play a role in what I'm going to say. So it's interesting now to know whether we are basically here. So this is telling us that there is no deviation from a hierarchy, or whether there is still some deviation. Actually, this plays a role both in models and also in what I'm going to say. So neutrino mixing also, of course, tell us about the mixing angles. And what we know is that there are three large mixing angles in the end, because even theta 1/3 is not that small. And if you compare with the mixing in quark sector, it's the smallest mixing angle is equal approximately to the largest mixing angle, the Kabibol angle in the quark sector. And we also, now the global analysis also starts to constrain the CP phases. excluding at 3 sigmas a certain interval, while we have no constraints on the Majorana phases that are not constrained by neutrino mixing, but possibly by neutrino double beta decay if we will find a positive signal.
You know the way of remembering the answers, right?
Yes.
What? 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, there are many different rules to remember. One, another one is that, okay, the, if you also plot the Khabibbo angle, there is some relation.
But I mean, 1, 2 is 34, so 1, 2, 3, 4. 2, 3, 4, 5.
Okay, I didn't know this mnemonic, but certainly.
1, 3, 9 is geometric.
But what is more important is that right now the global analysis indicate also to some statistical significance that normal order is favored over inverted ordering, with some delta chi-squared that it's not translated in sigma, because actually even the collaboration, the NuFIT collaboration, there is an internal discussion whether you should just take the square root if you think this is a chi-square with 1 degree of freedom, or it's a bit less, actually. Probably that is the truth, is that something like between 2 and 3 sigma. Okay, obviously, you could extend the standard model minimally, adding just Dirac masses, and then it would be very easy. The Dirac masses will be just the neutrino masses, but you will have very small Dirac neutrino masses compared to other known Dirac masses. Also, why there are large mixing angles compared to the quark sector, that's another kind of a strange feature. But I would say, very, even more importantly, you don't go very far if you want to explain the cosmological puzzles. And in any case, why not to add anyway also a Majorana mass term that is not forbidden by any symmetry? Also, because if you do that, so you add a Majorana mass term, then you can diagonalize this Majorana mass term, and what you get is that the mass eigenstates immediately have to be Majorana states, so the mass eigenstates are Majorana particles. If you go in the CISO limit, then the spectrum splits in two sets, 3 very light Majorana neutrinos, given by the CISO formula, so you understand why they're much lighter than the other fermions, and 3 very heavy Majorana neutrinos that can play a cosmological roles, as we will see. Plus, if you do a 1-generation to a model exercise, if you plug here for the heavy Majorana scale, the GATT scale, things seem to be go in the right direction, so you don't need a Dirac neutrino mass that is much different from the other Dirac masses. So the point is, the big point mystery in a type 1 CISO, this was a type 1 CISO case, is what are the right-handed neutrino masses? They are plugged by hand, and so therefore you have either to add some experimental information or some further theoretical information. Just to give you an idea, however, there are two extreme cases that are probably grasp a little bit most of the models. And the first case is that, so you diagonalize in a biunitary, so you bi-diagonalize the neutrino Dirac mass matrix with 2 unitary matrices, and this is the neutrino Dirac mass matrix in the flavor basis, where charge lepton mass matrix is diagonal. The first case is if all the mixing comes from the left-handed sector, so it's all contained in the mismatch between the neutrino and charge lepton mass matrix. And right-handed neutrino mixing matrix is basically the identity. If you do that, the lepton mixing matrix is, again, like in the Dirac case given just by this mismatch. But now the masses, instead of being equal to the Dirac mass masses, they are CISOed in a certain sense. They are given by the Dirac masses times the ratio between the Dirac masses to the heavy masses. Now you can, if you have a flavor symmetry, for example, this will force the neutrino Dirac masses to be all equal. And if this is again 100 GV, this common Dirac neutrino masses, this is the kind of heavy neutrino spectrum you get, for example, in a A4 models, very simple A4 models. Obviously, what is bad in this case is that they are, and this is the typical criticism to this kind of models, is that high energy models, they are untestable. At least certainly not at colliders in ground experiments. But still they can, for example, do provide, satisfy successful leptogenesis. Another possibility is that all the opposite case, all the mixing comes from the left-handed, from the right-handed sector. And in that case, the right-handed neutrinoma spectrum is a bit more difficult to, but you can show that these, you can find easily these expressions. If you also impose that the Dirac neutrino mass matrix are not too different from the upquark masses, and this is what you get typically in SO10 models, but beyond that, I would say in a broader category that we can call SO10 inspired models, then the spectrum is very hierarchical. And so you can see that you have many different options. In particular, so you can switch here on the EX scale, there is the lightest neutrino mass. And so you see that there is a, but in any case, for any value, the spectrum is very hierarchical. Cosmology can help understand the neutrino mass models, and vice versa. Neutrino physics, so these IV neutrinos can also help explain cosmological puzzles. So there is a synergy between the two phenomenology. So Mariano already talked of the baryon asymmetry. So this is measured now very precisely by the CMB anisotropies. And they don't say the sign of the baryon asymmetry, but we know that from the thermal spectrum of CMB and non-observation of cosmic rays from the annihilations of between matter and antimatter, if you think of the universe being symmetric and made of a patch of domains of matter and antimatter, we know that basically there is no primordial antimatter in the universe. Or if there is, it's very well hidden in a quite an exotic way, but it's not easy to segregate matter from antimatter. So that's why, in the end, these measurements of the baryon times H squared, basically, gives us a measurement of the baryon, of the Marion asymmetry, that can be parametrized in terms of baryon to photon ratio. And it's a small number, but as Mariano was discussing, however, it's a huge number when you try to reproduce it in the standard model. And that's why we need a new physics. And that's why neutrino physics also calls for new physics. And so that's why it is reasonable to think that the same as you can have a combined solution. So the heavy neutrinos, as I said, can have now an important role. The decays directly can produce a lepton asymmetry. And if you are above the sphaleron freeze-out temperature of 140 GV, then part of the lepton asymmetry will end up into a baryon asymmetry. So you need high temperatures in this case. So differently from the model that Ruzbe was saying. This is a whole picture. Let's say that if you plug different assumptions, the most important is that the lepton flavor composition of the final lepton is negligible, and also in a hierarchical spectrum of right-hand neutrino. And you assume that there is not too much fine-tune in the CISO, and then in that case you get an upper bound that Alejandro and Sasha Davidson obtain on the CP asymmetry. Then, first of all, okay, the asymmetry is contributed dominantly by the lightest right-handed neutrino. You can neglect the two heavier ones. And from this upper bound, you get immediately a lower bound on the right-handed neutrino mass. And since you want that this right-handed neutrino, you assume the thermal production, so the temperature is connected to the mass of the right-handed neutrino. Therefore, has to be not too much smaller than the light right-handed neutrino mass. You also get a lower bound on the rate temperature. But very interestingly, in this picture, you also get an upper bound on the absolute neutrino mass scale that, by the way, now it's verified, but obviously this success is not enough to say we proved the leptogenesis or this picture. Moreover, notice, however, that this lower bound seems to rule out the spectrum where the right-hand neutrino masses were very hierarchical, and the lightest neutrino was about 10 to the 6 GV. So it looks like that you cannot produce enough asymmetry from this, the lightest right-handed neutrino. However, it was noticed that flavor effects are very important, so it is not a good approximation to neglect the flavor composition of the final leptons. And what happens is that below between 10 to the 9 and 10 to the 12 GV, tau Yukawa interactions also will measure the tau component of the flavor asymmetry, and actually you have to follow the kinetic evolution of the tau on asymmetry and the electron plus mu on asymmetry independently. So there will be a correction to the final asymmetry. Below 10 to the 9 GV, also the muon flavor is measured, and actually you have to track separately electron, muon, and tau on asymmetry. If you consider again a scenario where only one radiant neutrino produces all the asymmetry, to be honest, I don't think there are big, after many, many papers, the conclusion, in my opinion, is that there are not huge implications of flavor effects. So it doesn't really change the lower bound, doesn't really change much the upper bound. But what is very importantly is the consequence for this kind of spectrum that I was writing, because now the asymmetry from the next to lightest actually can be very important. The reason is that if you don't consider flavor effects, this asymmetry is very efficiently washed out by the lightest radiant neutrino inverse decay, because this decay parameter, given the experimental results we observe, the atmospheric and solar neutrino mass scale, it's typically much larger than one. What I mean typically, well, it means that if you do a random generation of models respecting the neutrino masses and mixing, typically you manage to have this parameter less than one in something like 0.1% of cases. But if you now consider flavor effects, the washout happens separately in the three flavors, and one of the flavor decay parameters has much higher probability to be larger than one, something like 23%, or actually even more. So because of that, this spectrum might rescue those models coming from SO10-inspired models. Indeed, if you now plug also SO10-inspired conditions and you obtain this kind of spectrum, you get solutions. And what is very interestingly is that you get also, when you project, the asymmetry depends on the low energy neutrino parameters. And when you project on the points that you obtain on planes, selecting two parameters, you have empty regions. So it means that you get constraints. In particular, Majorana phases cannot be arbitrary, but they cluster around specific value. Also, notice that inverted ordering is ruled out. And so it's nice that it's in line with what we have now from global analysis. Another interesting thing, probably, in my opinion, maybe the most interesting, is that now you have a lower bound on the absolute neutrino mass scale. Here, let's say integrating out all the other parameters, this lower bound is only 1 millielectron volt, and even in cosmology, even in future with the BOSS satellite with different satellite, an experiment that will measure much more accurately the position and of many more galaxies in the sky. So we will, Euclid, we will be able to improve this upper bound, but not so low. However, as we will see, there is an interesting thing. Also, there is, as I said, in Majorana phases are constrained. And if you do this famous plot, generically you get this kind of region for normal ordering. Now you see you cut away part of the region, you still have not a lower bound, but it's now much more difficult to have, for example, for masses around millielectron volt, the typical effective neutrino mass for the neutrinoless double beta decay is around 7-8 millielectron volt. Okay, so the different color, I'm not explaining because it's a bit technical, but let's say it's only a difference that we between the yellow one is the orange one is if you constrain this matrix to be exactly one, it's an approximation that was used initially, and here we wanted to show whether it was working or not. And initially we were able to reproduce analytically these results. Now we extended the analysis also when you take a more general hypothesis, when you allow the angles in the VL to be within zero and those in the CKM matrix. So the blue one It's a very particular region where the final asymmetry is independent of the initial conditions, and we dubbed this a strong thermal leptogenesis. Actually, what is interesting is that only for this mass spectrum, when you consider flavor effects, you can have strong thermal leptogenesis. Then you are much more predictive, but I don't know if you notice, but okay, there is a very a strong upper bound, not strong, but let's say there is an upper bound on theta 2-3, and now the best fit, probably I was a bit fast, it's in the second octant. If this tendency will be confirmed, you will rule out strong thermal leptogenesis. Even so, I have to say that there is still one theoretical parameter that you didn't get rid of, is the ratio between the charged mass and the next two lightest neutrino Dirac masses. And here it's assumed, for this region, this is assumed to be 5. If you see, the asymmetry depends as alpha 2 squared, so if you go to already to 6, we show that this upper bound can be relaxed, and you can also, let's say, be in agreement with the second octant. Then, therefore, the exact prediction depends on the precise model. I know that yesterday I was talking with Fong, he's not here today, but with Babu, they are trying to have a workable model, realistic model, that realizes this leptogenesis. And the challenge in this realistic model now is second octant. It's very difficult. It's very difficult. You have a question?
No, no. Alpha 2 can be generated by higher order.
Let's say typically, SU10 model, they don't predict alpha 2. So it can be left. There are mass constraints. And what is interesting is that when you don't fit the theta 2-3, but not leptogenesis, also large theta 2-3 angles require large alpha 2. So I don't know if that is suggestive, but two independent things point to this value. I don't know if that has some deep reason. But anyway, another very important thing is that so far I was always plotting, you see, projecting on a plane, but actually these constraints live in a multidimensional space, and this can be important for the lower bound on M1. You can see that the lower bound becomes more stringent going toward the second octant slightly. But also, if you plot delta versus M1, in this region, it becomes much more stringent. And I didn't have time to tell you, but now, right now, the best fit is right here. If the best fit will be, if we are around this best fit, second octant and fourth quadrant for delta, then this lower bound for M1 becomes much, much more stringent. And actually, if you also plot, do a three-dimensional, let's say, plot of this lower bound, I can tell you that preliminarily we are obtaining 30 millielectron volt for N1, and it translates in 10 millielectron volt on neutrino-less double beta decay mass. That I think it's a nice motivation to insist with neutrino-less double beta decay experiments, even if normal ordering is confirmed, because there is a little bit of embarrassment. What if we spend a lot of money to test something that maybe is very small, and neutrino could be Majorana, but in normal ordering, in general, there could be phase cancellations. In this case, phase cancellations are not possible, and the effective neutrino mass is never too much smaller than M1, let's say. So I think this could be very interesting. However, we also want to describe dark matter, and also many people criticize this model, they are high energy, so it become popular to talk of low energy CISO models. The most traditional one is going to the degenerate limit. For example, two lightest red neutrinos are very degenerate, then you evade the Davidson-Ibarra bound, and the CP asymmetry and also the lower bound on the reading temperature on M1, and this becomes suppressed by the degeneracy of the two red and the neutrino masses. So you can go to low scale and still have successful leptogenesis. This will play a role now in the combined model of dark matter leptogenesis, so because we will do light leptogenesis exactly in this way. So we have to explain also dark matter. This is also measured very well by the SIMBY anisotropies. And a popular way is is lower in the scale indeed, because in that case you can enhance the left-handed, right-handed neutrino mixing. I didn't talk about it, but Actually, the Lyse neutrino states are dominantly left-handed, but not completely, and the AB neutrino states are dominantly right-handed, but there is a small admixture of left-handed. So there is a mixing. Because of that, if you go to low scale, and also if you take the limit where the lightest radio neutrino mass is smaller than the electron mass, then this can dominantly decay only into three neutrinos, and so therefore the lifetime is suppressed, gets much longer as the scale to the minus five, the Sargent rule. And you have and it becomes, let's say, for masses around KV, it's much longer than the age of the universe, so these are dark matter candidates. But you have to worry also of radiative decay that are subdominant. Due to the same mixing, you also have radiative decay. So you need that this lifetime, actually, it's many orders longer than the age of the universe. But what is very interesting is that for these masses, you also, within the CISO, generate the right correct dark matter abundance through the Dodderson-Widrow mechanism. So there was a lot of excitement when this was proposed, and also the lightness neutrino mass is very small, so you predict a hierarchy. But you have to be careful that this red neutrino can decay radiatively, and you have X-ray constraints. But this is an opportunity to test the mechanism. Indeed, the region, the loud region, is closing because of this constraint. So it's a very honest model that can be tested and constrained. Also, there are constraints, a lower bound on capital M1 that we were discussing yesterday, about 2-3 kV, basically, on the lightest radio neutrino mass. These constraints can be kind of circumvented if you go to a resonant production of dark matter, assuming that there is a large lepton asymmetry. But now it becomes more difficult. You have to produce the dark matter, but also a large lepton asymmetry. And if you want also to satisfy baryogenesis, you want to do also baryogenesis, you need to produce a small lepton asymmetry before sphaleron frees out, and a large lepton asymmetry after sphaleron frees out. So it's a lot of constraints. But it is possible, so if you consider resonant production, basically also the with a large lepton asymmetry, then you can also explain the baryon asymmetry from the mixing of the two heavier radiant neutrino. And the spectrum is more or less of this way, so the two heavier radiant neutrino cannot be too heavy. And what is maybe disturbing, or maybe in any case it's a fact, is that this works. So you can do both dark matter and baryon asymmetry if the mass splitting is of about order of 1 electron volt. So the specific mass splitting is 10 to the minus 10. So this is the kind of spectrum, and this is a region where you can do both dark matter and baryogenesis. And that is, and also if the radiant neutrino are lower than 5 GeV, you can have a possibility to test it with the B-Mason decays. So it's really nice from that point of view. However, recent analysis doesn't find any solution plugging M1 7 kV, probably because they use more recent data. This region was worked out in end of 12. So I don't know what is the status. If you still have they use more constraints on so everything is connected. The lepton asymmetry also is connected to the X-ray constraints and to the cosmological constraint. So these improved, and so it could be that now you need a larger lepton asymmetry to satisfy dark matter, but it is impossible to do it. So these authors fixing capital M1 equals 7 kV. By the way, in this way you could explain also the 3.5 kV anomaly. They don't find any solution. Yeah, in any case, no, non-resonant doesn't is excluded now. In any case, you need a large lepton asymmetry. Okay, so we found an alternative solution. How many minutes do we have?
A few minutes,
okay. So what we did was to assume that, okay, you have a 2-radian neutrino limit. 1-radian neutrino is decoupled, a very small Yukawa coupling, whether it's the lightest, the intermediate, or the heavier, you don't know. And it's very small, slightly coupled. But what is a very simple observation is that the abundance of dark matter scales like the inverse of the dark matter mass, of course. So if you go to very heavy masses now instead than KV, You actually need a mechanism that can convert, that have to produce a very tiny amounts of this right-hand neutrino, very heavy right-hand neutrino. We dub them Rhinos. So you have Wimpzilla, you have Rhinos that are kind of, now you will see around PV in the end. Now, how do you produce, however, this right-hand neutrino? If you say that the Yukawa couplings are not exactly zero, you don't go anywhere, because you need that this particle is long-lived, and the Yukawa coupling has to be extremely small, and you can't, there is no mechanism that with such small Yukawa coupling can produce the right-hand neutrino abundance. So what we have done is to introduce a five-dimensional operator that is a kind of upgrade of the Weinberg operator, where basically in the Weinberg operator you have five dagger phi and then the two lepton doublets. Here, now you think right-hand neutrino are very natural to produce neutrino masses and mixing, so we can build this operator. By the way, initially it was it's the same year when Wilczek did the paper on X portal. So it's an X portal operator. We didn't know that paper, to be honest, but you won't find explicitly this operator in the Wilczek paper. So I think originally it was first proposed here. This operator is interesting because it realizes a mixing between your dark matter neutrino that can be a gauge single living in the dark sector that very weakly couples to a right, mixes with a right-handed neutrino. And also it creates some matter effects in the early universe that you have to take into account. So the right-handed neutrino mixing is sensitive to the Higgs and to the potential created by the Higgs. But at the same time, also the Yukawa couplings of the source right-handed neutrino, let's say I can be, the dark matter, let's say, is just can be 1, 2, or 3 at the moment, and then the other, the source right-handed neutrino is one of the other three. Here the mixing angle is given by the mismatch between the two interactions, the Yukawa interaction and this new interaction, and this mixing angle is not like in the active sterile neutrino mixing we have seen before, it's not constant, but it depends on the temperature. So the calculation of the relic neutrino abundance is more difficult, and unfortunately we realized that, because as you will see, we first did a calculation in a simple way that now we realize it doesn't really work. So you use the usual formalism for neutrino mixing, when Hamiltonian formalism, and what you discover is that if the mass of the dark matter is larger than the source right-handed neutrino, the source right-handed neutrino enters the CISO formula, a two right-handed neutrino CISO formula, and necessarily has to have strong coupling, because you have to reproduce solar and atmospheric scale. So it will kind of thermalize at some point. If the dark matter mass is larger than the source, you have a resonance. And at the resonance, you can think of having a conversion of a neutrino, but non adiabatic. Actually, if it's adiabatic, you produce too much dark matter. So you have to convert just a small amount. And we used the Landau-Zener formula for this, because then we got an analytical formula for the dark matter abundance. And also you can get an idea of the scale of the new physics. It's huge. Actually, it's Trans-Planckian, and you can say now that it cannot be. Well, we cooked just a very simple example that tells you that this can be the combination of two scales, for example, a grand unified scale and a small scale coupling, the standard X to a heavy X, and then the new scale can be M squared good divided by mu, so it can be larger than the Planck scale. So it's not unphysical. This is what I want to say. However, the same mixing will also make the dark matter decaying now to decay through either two-body decays or four-body decays. The two-body decays, you can see it, let's say, in the basis of the mass eigenstates, it can be seen, in the basis where basically the, these are mass eigenstates, there is a mixing, you apply here the VEV, and then through the mixing, finally, the source right-handed neutrino decay into a gauge boson and a neutrino. Or you can think that this was a kind of Weinberg operator, so it will create an additional Majorana master, and therefore you have to diagonalize the Majorana master now, and this will make the zero in the column, in the Dirac-Mass matrix, not exactly zero. So you can see it also in this way. But anyway, two body they will decay somehow. and you get a lower bound on the mass. They also can decay to four body decays, and this produces an upper bound on the mass of the dark matter. Then what is interesting is that at that time, when we proposed the model with Anisimov, Ice Cube was still not known, so in 2009, and we already were saying in the paper that these are the typical mass scales probed by Ice Cube, by the way. So now the Ice Cube finds very high energy neutrino that are not understood in known ways. So it can be interesting whether these neutrinos can contribute to the Ice Cube flux. Indeed, also, as I said, leptogenesis will be realized. So this is the scheme. The dark matter is the heaviest red and neutrino, and the two lightest, order of typically TV, or 10, between TV and 10 TV, can do resonant leptogenesis. And also we presented two different schemes for improving Ice Cube feeds, either with a dark matter mass of order of 10 PV or 300 TV. I can tell you that right now there is a slight 1.5 sigma favor for a model like this compared to an astrophysical component, but there is still not, let's say, any hint, but it might become interesting. Also, let me say that unfortunately we realized that the Landau-Zinner is a too simplistic approach and you have to use a density matrix equation. This is the same density matrix equation that also is used in the new MSM model to calculate the baryon asymmetry, for example. And when you use this density matrix equation, this is a what you get from Landau-Zinner, you have an instantaneous production at the resonance. Since we have a hierarchy between dark matter and source, actually there are many orders of magnitude of difference. So the Landau-Zinner underestimate the dark matter abundance, and overestimates. And so we repeated the calculation, but now the allowed region before were obtained for a vanishing abundance of the source red and neutrino. That is more reasonable. While now we can get some solution also only if we assume that the source red and neutrino is initially thermal. Or we found also a new solution where the source red and neutrino is very light and less than 1 GeV, and then you can just start from initial vanishing abundance, but then you can don't do leptogenesis. By the way, these lines are the best fit for explaining this axis that I was telling you. It's actually around 200-300 TV exactly. So now you can protest and say what thermalizes the source red neutrino. We are working on that, but we think that the same operator can, the lambda SS term might be very strong actually, very large, and might thermalize the source red neutrino. And so it is possible likely to justify this assumption as well. This is, by the way, a plot where it's nice, a propaganda plot, where there is a thermalized source red and neutrino. Some of the abundance is transferred to the dark matter, so you produce a dark matter abundance. And then finally, you also produce a lepton asymmetry. So you satisfy simultaneously both. Summary, so I think CISO neutrino mass models obviously are able to reproduce neutrino masses and mixing, but also to address cosmological puzzles, not only leptogenesis, but also I hope I showed maybe also dark matter. And I think, notice that in these models I was presenting, there the lightest neutrino mass is strictly zero, so hierarchical. So I presented two different models, SO10-inspired model where you expect some deviation from hierarchical spectrum. While if you want the dark matter at the moment, it looks like you need a hierarchical model. So this is why I think absolute neutrino mass scale experiments will be very, very important in the next years to guide us toward the correct models. And of course, use density matrix equation if you don't want to make mistakes. That's the final conclusion. Thank you very much.
Questions? I do have one. So, you're trying to, you're saying that in your model you can accommodate Ice Cube events.
Yes.
And you have either two body or four body decays, right? That's right.
In the end, the red neutrino decay into gauge bosons and neutrino, and then this will generate, of course.
So the point is maybe one way how you can discriminate your model from other models, because there have been other proposals to explain the Ice Cube events, is because since you have four-body decays, your signature in gamma rays will be different from previous models, because you have also signatures in gamma rays which can be probed by Fermi, for instance. And then maybe it would be a way to...
Yeah, if we are in the region where four-body decays dominate, yes, it could be a good idea, yes. But also the flavor, I didn't have time, but the flavor composition of the prompt neutrinos is very, very precise. It's actually, is here, the plot. At the production, you have no electron component. This is another signature, might be a signature of this model, but we need a huge statistics, of course.
But I mean, even if you don't have charged leptons in the finite state, you just for neutrinos, you can have an off-channel, off-shell Z and generate gamma rays anyways.
Yeah, yeah, no, gamma rays is indeed, in these plots, they take into account, in this hint, they take into account also gamma ray constraints. Also, Bhupal did 1 year ago an analysis. Here, they also take into account gamma ray constraints, and but since the masses are very large, somehow you manage to avoid the gamma ray constraints.
Just a quick question. I'm not sure if I understood right from your last slides. It seems to me so that dark matter is not produced resonantly.
No, no, it's a kind of freezing solution, if you wish. Look.
It's a freezing
solution. So, if you want, it belongs to category of freezing solution. Where, so, you see, it starts from zero with small coupling, it's produced, and you get a final abundance.
Okay.
Thank you. The lepton asymmetry is produced resonantly.
Lepton asymmetry.
Yes.
More questions? Comments? So let's thank the speaker again. And we convene at 2:30. Okay? So remember, you can leave your things here. The room will be locked. Okay?
The problem is that no, that's not the problem.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we hope.